I'm Scott L. Miller. It's the 31st of August, 2023. This is my vlog of daily life living in León, Nicaragua. Today, we've got a user question. He's working in Texas, but he wants to move to Nicaragua, or maybe wants to move to Nicaragua, and he wants to know how he could work remotely for a company in Texas. This works out perfectly because I work remotely for a company in Texas from Nicaragua, so we're going to be going into that right after the bump. On this channel, we spend a bit of time talking about ways that you can work remotely because that's how you have to work in Nicaragua. That's just the mode of operation necessary for being able to have an income if you still need to work while living in Nicaragua. So this is a more specific question, but we're gonna pop it up here so you guys can see what the original question is. And oddly, this got some really weird, aggressive, nasty feedback from people on the conversation. I have no idea what about asking how to do your job remotely it would ever engender that kind of response, but we definitely had against both him and me just for having a channel from here, which of course, trolls on the internet, right? And I've talked to other people who have YouTube channels here. They're like, instantly, as soon as you mention Nicaragua, it's just so much hatred comes out. And it's so sad that that's what the world that we live in, but it's always been that way, right? People have always hated places just because of what their nationality is or what ever may be about that place. And of course, there's a lot of jealousy, especially from the north, of people who feel trapped in North America are very jealous of those of us who have managed to escape or they perceive as being able to escape, such as this person who is looking to move from Texas to Nicaragua, as I did, right? And being able to work, because if you don't have a job that lets you do that, finding out that there are people who are able to take their jobs, move to paradise, earn the same money and have it go 3, 4, 5 times as far is upsetting, right? When you find out that your career choice maybe precluded you, or the company that you work for, or your family situation, or your prejudices may make it unavailable for you to live the kind of lifestyle you wish you could, that can evoke a very emotional response. So the assumption is that these people are primarily simply jealous and lashing out because they wish that they could be here. And maybe they're banned from being here, right? Maybe their political activities have made them persona non grata in much of the world. There are a lot of people like that. It doesn't take very much to put yourself on a list that doesn't make it easy for you to travel to other countries. They look at your passport and say, ooh, you've been pretty active against us online. We'd really rather if you weren't hanging out here. Remember, you're a guest. And it's best to behave as one, right? Also, a lot of places are unhappy about people who spread fake news. So if that's something that you're tied to, that can cause a problem traveling as well. It's very similar, but one is definitely a negative. The other is a negative behavior, but may be in a positive direction, but it's a dangerous one. So countries tend to look at that stuff, and it is always, it doesn't matter what country you're talking about, the US is absolutely no exception, right? They completely look at your social media, even of US citizens coming in, and you can have a hassle or complete banishment, not as a US citizen, but as others coming in and having had any amount of online interaction. The concept of freedom of speech, even in the US, is completely limited to citizens, not to tourists. So really, this is a technical question. How can you work for a company that's in Texas when you're not living in Texas? Well, this is mostly based around the type of work you're doing and the technology that you have, so it's hard to answer all these things. If you have a company that's fully modernized and works in a good, secure manner, then you need to do nothing. Any modern technological environment is able to work from anywhere. Now, if your job physically requires, you know, putting pipes in place, that's not going to solve that. But if you have an office job and you're working on a computer, we all know what we mean when we say being able to work remotely. If you're doing that kind of job and your company is fully modernized, like the one I work for, then you can work anywhere in the world at any time and your location never matters, except for the things that can't be helped, such as latency of your connection. We talked about that in our internet speeds video just the other day, but basically that is simply the physical distance of the cables between where you are and where you're trying to connect to. And if they get too far, they start to create performance problems. But beyond that, where you work in the world should be transparent and agnostic to your technological systems, because there is never, and this is important, never a security reason for looking at the technological location of your access or the perceived technological location of your access in regards to security. There are some places that use pre-designated spots, such as your house has been authorized, and so if you move, you have to reauthorize your house. That's slightly different. But if you are able to work from your home in Texas, for example, why would you not be able to work from your home not in Texas? How do they know you're not in Texas? The answer is they don't. They're guessing. Right, and they may have a pretty good guess, but they are guessing. And anyone who's trying to work around that security would do so so quickly and so easily that they would be unlikely to be aware that that security was there. So it is very important, and as a general rule, when you're working with IT, never let people lie, because they will use those lies to establish a lot of things very quickly. And that's true in anything, but in IT, it's very common because so many people don't understand the basics that it's easy or perceived as being easy to simply make up very obvious lies, completely non-plausible scenarios, and present them as if they are true and expect that people will never question you. One of those is that you can use something called Geo IP blocking, where you detect the IP address that someone is using and use that to determine where they are and then block them by their location. There's so many reasons that this doesn't work and makes no sense. And actually, I want to do a little talk on that at the end because it's very important and it's prescient, because people who live in Nicaragua are constantly getting blocked because of this. And to be frank, I've had discussions with technologists about this. I've never heard an argument against it that it was either completely falsified, right? Oh, well, maybe there's a law that says no. There's no law that says you have to detect IP ever. It makes no sense. And if there was such a law, it would be shot down as illegal in any reasonable country, because the IPs do not determine anything. They do not determine nationality. They do not determine location. They do not determine race, but they do trend. And so the only way you can use them is to block trends. And the only time you block trends is racism, and that's never okay. So there's never an okay time where you block by GeoIP. It's a thing. So, but if a lot of companies do this because either they're abject incompetent, or, and that could be at any level, right? It could be a CEO that pushes it down and IT has no say. It could be IT who's just trying to, they think doing something fake is going to make their bosses think they're doing something good, right? And that's a really common thing. It's what we call politics over profits, where you're trying to keep someone who's uninformed and clueless happy, and you perceive them as having no value. And so you're manipulating them to try to make them think you did a good job, even though you know you didn't. It's a common thing, especially in the US, where we have, go look at my blind economy video, the blind capitalism, because that's what creates that, right? A situation where we don't care if we're making the most money. We care that our investors perceive us as doing what we're supposed to do. And that's where we actually make our money, not from the clients. And so politics is more important than the profits. So that kind of stuff, or just abject incompetence. Many IT professionals have no training, have no clue, and no critical thinking. And so they simply do things that maybe sound good or some salesperson convinced them of, because salespeople aren't trained and know nothing about it. And it is not their job to. It is your job as the IT person. So they do this stuff. So we find geo-blocking a lot. And living in a country like Nicaragua, where there is a high degree of racial and regional disgruntlement with the region, or simply dislike for the people who live here, then it is really common to block resources here. And it could be anything. We find that stores will block so that you can't shop here. Like, as an American, I am blocked not by like Amazon, they know what they're doing, but much smaller companies that are willing to, you know, lose customers for personal beliefs, they will block all of Latin America and be like, if you're an American and you dare to travel to Latin America, we will block you. And not just block you, but offer the impression that we've gone out of business and that our website has failed and we no longer do shopping online, in order to make sure we don't retain you as a customer, because they are so either clueless, and I mean the degree that you have to be business stupid to make this mistake, right? Which legitimate customers do you want to lose to block people who can't shop with you anyway from shopping with you? Ask that question of investors directly, and you will never get an investor who's like, yes, throw away those customers. But if you ask it and then filter it, oh, do we want to protect against, they won't ask something real, they'll ask something fake and try to pretend it's a good thing. But if you're a CEO that allows this, you're violating fiduciary responsibility, black and white, right? If you're a business owner and you're doing this, either you're an idiot or you're racist, or of course both, they go together quite often, but those, that's how it works. And it doesn't matter what region you're blocking, right? When do you want to turn away a customer? And the thing that they're doing, let's imagine Amazon did this. Clearly Amazon is not doing this, so I'm using them as an example who would never do it. But imagine if they did. I'm an American, I live down here. I want to buy something and have it shipped to my dad's house. Maybe it's a gift for my dad. Maybe it's something for me that I'm going to pick up later. Maybe, who knows, whatever. I'm an American, I have an American credit card, I have an American address. I would like to send an American product from a store to the place where I live. They don't need to know where I'm ordering from, right? That has nothing to do with this scenario. There is no law ever that says you may not, as an American with the right to have an action, not place that action while on vacation, right? There are specific Department of Defense laws that have some very specific requirements about location of people who are doing work. Those are different. Those are military laws, and even they don't do this, right? They may do a lot, but they don't do this. They actually block by where you are, not by where you're perceived to be. It's very important. There can be, there are not very often, but there can be laws that say you may not work from Nicaragua. I understand that there are times that those can have to exist, and the Department of Defense is a good example of when they have a reason for that to exist, right? Oh, you cannot be in another country because we can't keep eyes on you all the time like we do when you're in the U.S. Okay, I understand. That's a specific case, but that is not Geo IP blocking, that is geo blocking, right? That is saying you may not get on an airplane and go there. When you Geo IP block, you say you may go there, but you may not use their IP addresses. You have to VPN somewhere and use someone else's. That's insane. You have to go jump through hoops to pretend you're not there so that we can pretend we secured things in a way. Anytime you use pretend with security, you're anti-security, right? That means you're lying to people to trick them. That itself is a security violation at the most basic level. That's social engineering. So if you're using GeoIP blocking because someone thinks that, or someone perceives that as being secure, you just hacked them, potentially violating U.S. federal guidelines. We're talking U.S. here, but this ethically applies the same anywhere, logically applies the same anywhere. You are using their idiocy to trick them into thinking you secured something that you did not. That's about as anti-security as you reasonably get before you actually start breaching things yourself. That is attempting to make people have a false sense of security so that, who knows what? So you get paid for not doing your job most of the time. But it is also exactly what you do if you're being paid off to lower the shields and allow the enemy in without anyone suspecting anything because your boss signed off on it, so it can't be your fault. Nice play. You managed to indemnify yourself while clearly doing something illegal or unethical and throwing your blind investors who have no ability to watch over your shoulder into the fire. Okay, so GeoIP blocking is something you have to deal with here for everything, right? And it can be, like I said, it can be shopping. You go to buy something online and you find out that they won't allow you to look at the store or place an order from where you are. I have this problem with motion VFX that I buy my special effects from on the show. I had to work with them a bit because they attempt to make things available everywhere, but they work with a rather unscrupulous American credit card processor, Paddle. I will call them out. I think they are terrible people. And they will take your credit card and then block it by their perceived location of where you have the credit card. Basically, what this does is it is a tax against people who don't have the technical wherewithal, capability, or knowledge to simply work around the block. So it has no security purpose because anybody who is actually looking to do something nefarious would work around it just like that. They would never actually run into the problem in the first place. They would always VPN to the US first and attack as if they're coming from the US. Instead, they take your credit card information and without any explanation, they simply turn down your payment, hurting both you as the consumer and Motion VFX, in this case, as the customer. They don't tell their customer that they, based on physical location of a perceived IP address, or the other way around, perceived physical location of an IP address, that they've turned down their custom. If I was a customer of Paddle and found out that they were picking and choosing the nationality, the perceived nationality, the willingness to associate with nationalities of my customers, that I find out that my customer who lives in California happens to be visiting friends and family in Nicaragua and they were presented with a failed credit card with no explanation because Paddle doesn't want the business of anyone who would visit Latin America. That's an unbelievably strong statement to send to your customers It's also a really strong statement to send to your employer or your the person who's employing the services in this case, that Paddle made that decision on behalf of Motion VFX. Motion VFX was like, how do we work around this? And we did. I simply logged into one of my computers in the United States, placed the order from there, and it went right through, which is how we figured out that Paddle was silently turning down customers for them, even ones that were Americans, just happened to be traveling. And if you think about Motion VFX and what they make, a lot of their customers, I don't know if it's a huge percentage, but a good percentage of their customers are people like me who do travel shows or digital nomads or whatever. Blocking digital nomads from a great number of the locations, possibly all the locations that they would work from, it's a significant problem when they're your core customers. And especially when the company in question isn't even American. It's a European company using an American credit card processor. Why would they be blocking Latin America when we're already a multi-region company that should know that their customers are multi-regional? It's a global product being advertised globally. They're paying for ads to come to me here in Nicaragua. They need to be aware that those customers are being charged, or they're being charged to show them ads, but are not being able to get the revenue from those customers because their credit card processor thinks it's funny to turn them down. I take geo-blocking very personally because it is an attack on not only the people who live in the areas that are blocked, but anyone who associates with them. It is a very strong statement of if you're willing to associate with the races or the locations or the peoples of this region, we would rather not have your business. And in the US, that type of freedom of speech and discrimination through business choices is legal for the most part. In most of the world, it is not. In all of the world, it is unethical and unacceptable. It is never an okay thing as a human to choose to not do business with someone based on their race, their nationality, their perception of association with a race. Those things are unthinkably evil. But it is protected as free speech in most cases in the United States. So while you can get away with it because their credit card processor is located physically in the US, it's not okay and it doesn't make sense. And if I was an investor of that company, I would be pretty livid and the conversation would instantly move to one with my lawyers and not one with me because I did not hire them to make commentary about my company's racial choices or regional choices or linguistic choices, but rather I hired them to process credit cards, something they refused to do, while also making a very strong customer experience statement I don't think they were aware of. So that's the problem that we face, is things like that. And so how do we work around things like that when we live and work in places like Nicaragua? And this applies all over the place. It could be Mexico, it could be Argentina, it could be France, it could be, you know, Uganda. Right? All of these places are gonna face the same problems. How do we make ourselves look like we're somewhere when we work for a company that both doesn't have the technology to let people work securely from anywhere as they should? This is not a current thing. Anybody that's current to the last 20 to 25 years does not have this problem. It is only companies that are running on infrastructure designs from the 1990s and older that face this. But sadly, the average one does, and even new startups are often implementing ancient architectures because they jump in without getting proper IT oversight, and once it's entrenched, it's entrenched. It's amazing how fast terrible old network designs become the norm before anyone has a chance to do anything about it. So there's a number of considerations for this, and again, it all depends on what your company does. In the specific question that was asked, one was how to deal with physical mail. Well, he's in Texas, she, I don't know who it is in Texas, same as my company. And how do we deal with this? Now, we would deal with this on a company-wide scale because our entire executive staff is here in Latin America, spread out between Mexico and Nicaragua. So we have to deal with mail processing in the US all the time. And this is generally pretty easy. You have a couple of choices. One, especially because I assume we're dealing with an individual here, not their company. So when you're dealing with this as an individual, simply consider that maybe, first of all, cut your mail down as much as possible. Two, find a family member who's willing to just handle a little bit of mail for you. How much is it really? It's probably extremely little. Maybe you're an exception, but for the majority of people that are asking this question or would be asking this question, sorry, it is really hot out here today and we have no air conditioning. You know, it's as simple as, oh, can your dad, can your mom, can your sibling, do you have a kid, like someone who's still in the United States, has an address, isn't bouncing around all the time, that you can just send the rare letter to, the rare check to, whatever. and let them handle it. That's the standard. That's what most people do, right? It's free. It's simple. It people don't even notice. If my friends ask me to do that, oh, Scott, you're living in Nicaragua. I need to send mail there. If I had 20 friends who did that, I still wouldn't notice the volume of mail that would come of legit mail, right? Not a big deal. Now, of course, here there is no mail, right? So you can't deliver anything to me, but that would be so simple. And so that's as easy as it is. If you have a high volume and you can't do that, or you simply have no friend or family that you could ask to do that to, okay, then there are services. These are not that expensive and they are available all over the place. We happen to have ours in North Texas in the Dallas area. And it is an office space where we actually hire a receptionist slash office manager, and they do a number of tasks for us to be physically done in the state of Texas. And one of the really important ones is they receive all of the mail, they open it all up, they look at what's junk mail and throw it away, they look at what's a bill and they scan it and send it to us, they look at what's a check and they take it out and they deposit it for us. So they make bank runs like once a week, not every day. And they handle all that physical mail stuff. If we need to send something out, we digitally send it to them. They print it out, put it in the mail for us. So sending, receiving, having a physical address in Texas that you can send a letter to, all of that is handled by them. In our particular case, we have a dedicated suite address. So we actually have an office in Texas that they operate out of and do that. We're a fairly large company with a lot of mail going through. You could do it with a shared address, of course, or just a PO box. You have a lot of options. But whether you just hire a high school student who does it on the side, or you hire a service that does it professionally. Obviously, services are better, but if you're only talking about a few things and it's personal, why not find a family friend who wants 2 hours of work per week and you're paying them $20 and you're helping someone out, right? Be creative, but it's not hard to do. But if you really need that, services exist. They're pretty easy to find. They're not too expensive, and they will automate all of that for you and just scan things so you can operate with a great degree of assurance that your mail is being handled. And in fact, it's generally handled way better because it's someone who professionally handles mail, as opposed to when we did it ourselves, we would have to go out, get all the mail from the mailbox, sort through it, often in the middle of other things, and end up missing things. So it actually has improved, I think, because of that process. And they go to the bank for us, which saves us a lot of time. So it's actually providing a lot of benefits. So the actual cost of it, the loss, is extremely little. Now, when it comes to phones, this is one we did an episode on this just recently, so I recommend you go back and watch that. But you don't forward phones. That's really something you never do. There's got to be an exception, but I can't think of when it really is. Forwarding is a break in your phone system. Now, any modern company, any even remotely modern company that has phones, right? Now, if you don't have phones, if you're so modern and you just don't have phones, that's different, fine. Then what do you need to deal with? But if you do have phones, all modern phones, anything classified as a business phone since the early 2000s, like 2001, 2002, is able to go anywhere in the world, simply plug in and work. They don't have any, there's no technological barrier to them working anywhere. Anything that would not work that way, of course, you can have specific rules in your security settings that don't allow them to move around. You have to like select it. Okay, that's security, and still rare and often doesn't make sense, but it can. But in the case of it won't work that way, that means you're running on a 1990s or older style phone system. It is costing you an arm and a leg guaranteed, and your company is seriously needing of help. Bring us in, please. Like, that is a level of holy cow. How does someone screw up that badly for that many decades when it is so easy to make your company more secure, more efficient, whatever? Okay, so email our link, the info@relocatenicaragua.com link, and ask about phone services or consulting services. When you've got things that bad, let us come in and save your company, please. That would be fantastic. It's not normally what we advertise, but go for it. That's actually our other company will respond, but we would love to help people with these kinds of problems. My gosh, it's amazing the things we run into. Speaking of which, that website, for people who have been following, we're on a month and a week now, still down, no change. They're still on a parking site by GoDaddy. So funny. Okay. So with any modern phone, you just take it with you. You don't have to forward. You don't have to do anything. It will just work. Now, of course, you're going to say, but Scott, it's going to show up as being somewhere else. Yes, we'll get to that in a second. Okay. So that just works. Your computer just works. There should be nothing on your computer that doesn't just work to where you are, and on. That's pretty much how it's going to be. So physical mail, yeah, someone's got to handle it because you're just not there. But you could be down the street. Doesn't mean you're far away. Just means you don't want to physically deal with your mail. Everything else, all technology should be completely agnostic to where you are. Now, you're going to say, okay, all that's true, Scott. That's great in this idealistic, you know, theoretical world. But here in the real world, people are going to have detectors. This is not actually very common, but it could be. Detectors for where people connect from. They're going to look for the IP address. They're going to track it. And they're going to know it trends towards being in a certain country. And then they're going to investigate and find that I'm in that country. How do I protect against that? Simply saying everything should work does not protect against that. You're correct. So the way that we do this is there's two different ways to hide your IP. One is having all of your computers actually be in the place that they want them to be in, let's say Texas in this case. So your computers physically sit in Texas and you automate your computers remotely, meaning you actually, let's say you have a desktop, and there's lots of ways to do this. I mean, it could be a laptop, right? A laptop sitting in a very, very, very tiny office or your friend's garage or whatever, and it's powered on, it's connected to the internet, and you remote into using some tool like Mesh Central or Screen Connect or ConnectWise or whatever, log me in, and you connect to that remotely in RDP session. You got lots of ways to do this, and you work on it remotely. Anything they do to track where you are, no matter what they do, it will always show that you are in Texas because you are in Texas. Right, because when they say, where are you? The question is not where are you, is where is your computer? And your computer is in Texas. It will have an IP from Texas. Now, of course, when I lived in Texas, my IP came from Canada for some reason. So everything thought I was in Canada. So those systems don't work very well, right? When I worked in New York, it always registered me as London. When I worked in London, it registered me as Germany. I have worked all over the world and almost never does it get it right. Here, it actually gets it pretty close most of the time, more than most places. But sometimes it shows me as Managua 2 hours away, which is close, but no cigar. So if you have a computer in Texas and anyone tries to test anything, whether it's the ping distance, the latency number, whether it's the Geo IP registration, whether it's the routers that it connects to, every single test will pass as being in Texas. They can do as much interrogation as they want because it is in Texas. They have no way ever, technologically, unless they actually have a person following you around, which is not technological, to know where you physically are. So whether you're remoting into that computer with Mesh Central or you're operating a pair of sticks with gloves glued to the end and going boop, 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 boop from thousands of miles away and just hoping you hit the keys correctly, they don't know. Whether you've grown arms that are so long that you can operate it from another country, they don't know because you're actually hitting the keys of the keyboard, actually moving the mouse, and actually using that computer that's in Texas. I do this all the time. I keep a set of computers in California and a number across the US. I can appear to be in a number of different states because I'm actually using my computers in those states. So that's really handy for a lot of things. Mostly we use it for testing. When we want to say, I want to know absolutely what an experience would be for someone sitting in Memphis right now and for someone sitting in Los Angeles right now. And we can look and say, okay, this website's up for this person and down for this one, or fast for this person or slow for this one, or they're getting different content or whatever. We're able to test those things very concretely because there's no chance that we got the configuration wrong. Those are computers actually sitting there. That's how we use them. That's extreme, but works 100%. It is absolutely indetectable. It is unguessable. Now, they may guess where you are because you got a picture in the background and they can see the ocean over your shoulder. That's on you. But if you're just trying to look from a technological level, your computer is not with you. So when they say you traveled, you say, oh yeah, I traveled, but I left my computer at home. Anytime you see me working, that's in Texas. They'd be unable to prove otherwise until they come to your house. Then just say you're at someone else's house. So the other option, though, the more practical one, is some sort of VPN. Now, VPN, the term, is a very specific technological one, and in the consumer industry, it has been co-opted by something that is a VPN, but in a very specific use case, is not necessarily what we mean. So we do not refer to necessarily the kinds of VPNs that you hear about, you know, Surfshark or Nordic VPN or whatever. Not that those aren't VPNs, not that they may not be the right thing for this solution, but they're not specifically what we're referring to, so don't read into that too much. You could use those for certain cases, but just be aware, when I say VPN, I'm not implying those types of VPNs necessarily. Also not ruling them out. So a VPN, at its basic level, creates a tunnel from where you are to where you want to be and puts your traffic through that so that the traffic, but not your computer itself, is coming from that other location. Think of it like a wormhole for your data on the network. There's a couple ways to do this. The way that you're used to with the ones that I mentioned is that you put a piece of software on your laptop, on your phone, whatever, and when you connect, it that connects first, and then it sends data through this tunnel so that that data appears to come from Dallas, Miami, wherever you want it to come from. You can move it around, do different countries. That's how people fool Netflix and stuff like that. But they get used to detecting which addresses are associated with those VPNs, and so they can detect that a popular VPN is in use in many cases, and can say, hey, you're using an IP that is clearly not your own. That belongs to NordicVPN, for example. Stop using that, and let's see where you really are, and then you got to figure something out. So that's a danger of those. Very few people are going to do that kind of detection, but it is a possibility. VPNs traditionally were used to take your office network and connect it to people working remotely already, but they would use it where they put a VPN. They would put a VPN device in their office, and people still do this all the time, and you have a VPN device or software at your home, and you connect that directly from the office to your home, and it actually appears like you're sitting inside the office. That's a more powerful way to do that. That is also a 1990s thing. Anyone who is doing that is bypassing all modern security mechanisms and using ancient security paradigms that are incredibly dangerous, or at least suggestive that they are. Could you use a VPN and not do that stuff? Technically, yes. But would there be any purpose to? Absolutely not. So it doesn't quite work that way. Like, why you would just turn off the VPN and not have to worry about it and increase your security. VPNs in practice actually reduce security for the company. The advertising that you use a VPN to increase your security when you're in a cafe or whatever isn't exactly untrue, but it borders on being untrue. But it is very misleading, because under normal circumstances, the usual use of a VPN is to breach security. It is to bypass security, not to enable security. So in those cases, you're trying to get through a network that is inherently insecure by doing something a little bit weird, and that's fine. But in general, you're going to be using VPNs to violate security rules, not to enforce them. So what we normally talk about is as VPNs don't really work very well for what we need in this case. But what we can do is a few different creative things. It depends on what it is you need to do. If you're working with a normal computer and you need to make that computer appear like you're in the United States, depending on what your employer uses, you may be able to, and this is only if your employer is trying to track you down. If your employer is just looking for you to do a good job and all they care about is the result of your work, they would never care about this. Like, by definition, a business decision could never include this. This only is if they care about something other than the quality of your work, right? If they're measuring your work and it doesn't get worse, maybe gets better, and then they say, oh, but wait, you got better while working in a place we don't like, because we don't like that you're happy, we don't like that you pay less to live. They care about something other than their business. They're actually sabotaging their business in order to spite you, right? Cutting off their nose to spite their face. That's the situation that they'd be in. So, and lots of companies do that, but it's important to recognize that no good employer would ever let it cross their minds to do something like this. Going out, seeking to find a way to ignore the results of a person's work and seek out where they live in order to punish them for not being in a country or a region or a culture that they personally like and are willing to hurt their company to do so, means they're willing to completely throw the concept of business under the bus. They're not there to make money. They're willing to lose money in order to hurt people because they're looking to hurt you, right? They're going out of their way only to punish you for being happy in a way they don't like. So this has no place in any valid, ethical, or simply attempting to be business. But the average business will do these things because the average business has zero interest in actually maximizing profits or working ethically. They don't tend to do that. And when you say those things, the one, they don't tend to work ethically, everyone would agree. Yeah, companies are kind of evil under most circumstances. But when they aren't trying to maximize profits, unless you work in business, this may seem antithetical, but it is not. Absolutely. You work especially in a publicly traded company, or even more so in a nonprofit. The idea that you're going to work towards the stated goals of the company is, it never even crossed anyone's mind to do so. All the people working at the company are there to figure out how to do what's best for them personally, and they could care less about the actual profits of the company because the people who oversee the company, on and on and on, go look at my video on blind economics, blind investing. So blind capitalism is the actual name of the video. I'll get it right eventually. So what we need to do to hide that, if we need to hide, then we need some type of VPN, unless we do the thing I already talked about, having your computers in the U.S. or wherever, where you need to get your traffic to route through the U.S. And yes, VPNs do that. So the things we've talked about, like Surfshark and Nordic VPN or NordVPN, I actually don't know their names, will do that under most circumstances. You need to be diligent, make sure they're on and working, test what IP you come up as. That's very easy. You can do that with a web browser. Like, it's not hard. You can do that stuff, and then the traffic coming from your computer will show up as being from wherever it is supposed to be. Now, of course, they may install stuff on your computer, right? If you have a company computer or you have a personal computer and you're letting them install things, they may install things that work around a VPN and feed information back to them that, in some cases, may even be illegal, right? Telling them where your house is or whatever. So be aware of that stuff. Most employers won't do that, but some will. So be aware that GPS trackers and other things may exist in some of the company software and may be being used. So that adds some complications, and that's why, one, look for a good job that wouldn't do that, or that doesn't care where you are and doesn't use that information against you, but uses it to help you. What if you needed emergency services? Well, it'd be nice if they could help you, right? So there's good reasons to have that information. Only work for an employer who would use that stuff for good reasons, and generally would not pull that information from you anyway. And if you are stuck and you have to work for an employer that's going to do that, then be aware you may have to hide a lot of that. And that's where having your computer in the States, any GPS, any software they install, any workaround they try to do will never be able to catch you, because you're not remote. Your computer, the thing that they're actually looking at, is not remote. But the VPN will hide the majority of things. Very, very few companies are going to detect that you are using a VPN, that you are where you actually are, anything like that. And you'll normally have a heads up if they're going to. Now, those solutions are not super robust. They're not designed to be. If you need to get really robust, you need to get to a situation where, like, every single device in your house is going to appear like you're in Texas, for example, then you're going to want to do something that is more like a hardware VPN, because your problems are going to be like your phone or whatever. They're not going to go through that VPN. There's no software for them to do that. So they're going to give you away. So you need something that's going to cover all of your devices. It could be your phone. It could be your desktop. It could be a laptop. It could be the phones that you use, whatever. Those, if you're going to have all those things, you're going to need a hardware VPN. This is how we do it old school. None of this is weird for an IT department. Any IT professional should have lots of experience in doing this stuff. Maybe not the specific task with this stuff, but working with VPNs and doing things like this, very easy. There's also, I need to point out, when we talk about having, a desktop at your friend's house, there's also services in the United States that give you virtual desktops inside a data center, like Amazon does that, right? You could do it on Vulture. Now, some of those are a little bit expensive, so you want to shop around. Like, you can do it relatively cheaply, but some places offer really expensive ones. But if you're saving tons and tons and tons of money to live in Nicaragua, sometimes that expense is pretty nominal. Plus, you have a great desktop that you can use from anywhere, anytime, bunch of security, great backups. Like, there's benefits to it on top of the things that we mentioned. So, and a lot of this comes down to, there's a lot of variables. Are they supplying your computer? Are you supplying your computer? Is it going to be Windows? Is it going to be Linux? Is it going to be Mac? Are they going to make you stop by a store and do stuff? Are they going to make you do visits? Like, there's so many things that we can't answer. So you have a VPN. What we used to do, and this still works, is you get a hardware VPN in your router. So just get a business class router. All business class routers have this. Good ones will not be expensive. This is one of those weird things in IT. The good ones won't be expensive. The bad ones will be expensive. So bad things, SonicWall, Cisco's, things that are really scams. No, like, legit IT people don't put those in place. They're for resellers, right? Salespeople who are not your friends, they'll sell you that stuff. It's super expensive, has annual licensing, all kinds of things. But good stuff like Ubiquiti, very cheap, very accessible, does not have annual fees, doesn't have limits, comes with all the features you need. Few hundred dollars, a tiny investment for having a really good home network. And let's face it, it's good to have a firewall at home anyway. So why not do that stuff? It works out really well. So it's not a huge negative. It's a small amount of outlay, but nothing compared to, say, a month's rent that you're going to be saving. So it's a really great approach to be able to do that. So get something like a Ubiquiti router, and there's cheaper ones. That's a really good option, especially if you have IT friends who can manage it remotely for you. That can work out great. You put something like that in, and then you need to have something for it to connect to. Could be a friend's house. That could work out great. You pay them a few dollars to use their internet some of the time. Or maybe you put a cloud server in a data center. Again, not a lot of money. You might be looking at between $5 and $14 a month in order to have something running in a data center, such as in your case, because we're talking about Texas, a data center in Dallas. I do most of my data center work in Miami because of where we're located, but we do use Dallas and Chicago and New York, and it's very flexible. We set up a server. Of course, you're going to need someone who works in IT to do this, but this is easy stuff. They can set up a VPN connection point there. So your hardware VPN in your house connects to that, and it takes everything coming from your house or everything coming from the work portion of your house. It can split it so that your home equipment doesn't go through that firewall and your work stuff does, right? And you have a mix, so you're able to do local traffic for things that should be local and office traffic through the US for that stuff. And it can tunnel all of that traffic, all of it in a single bundle, up through this VPN to Dallas in this example. And then from there, it goes to the internet. So it, anyone who sees that traffic coming from there will see it coming from the data center in Dallas, and it'll just be local traffic. It'll look like it's right in town. Now, maybe you're in Houston, you want to put it in Houston, or Dallas, doesn't matter if you're in Houston, whatever. But that's a common approach that works extremely well. Companies have been doing that for decades, and individuals often don't. But as someone who works in IT, I know IT professionals do this since the 90s. This is a standard technique that we've used to hide things like this all the time or to provide functionality that we otherwise didn't have. Now, I don't do this currently. I don't know anyone who needs to do this anymore. It's such an archaic thing. But if you work for a company that has old style software and is looking to lock things down in this way and try to curtail you, but doesn't make a rule about it, just makes it technologically difficult, this is an easy workaround and it will get your phones as well. Now, the way that you asked the question, this is worth noting that phones come in two basic flavors, your own and theirs, right? If they're supplying the phone, then yes, you want to have it behind a VPN so it appears to come from Texas. Again, if they care, only if they care. If they don't care, you don't have to do anything, right? It should just work, same as it would if when you're at home in Texas. Being in Nicaragua does not pose any new technical challenge, right? None of your equipment knows it's in Nicaragua. It all operates the same. The internet's the same everywhere. So if they don't care, you're all good. If you have a company phone and you need it to pretend it's in Texas, then it just needs to go through one of these VPNs, not very hard. And once you have that bundled hardware VPN, everything goes through it. You don't need to like configure it for different devices. So that's really easy. You just plug things in, like you have a switch or a Wi-Fi unit that's just for that and everything that connects to it through the VPN. So it makes your life very easy when that's what you're doing. The thing that you had mentioned, though, was should you forward your phone to a service? And this is a little bit weird. Why would you need to forward? Where would that thing forward to? You certainly are never going to, under any circumstance, use as a phone service in Nicaragua. That doesn't make any sense from a technical standpoint. What purpose would you have for having one in Nicaragua? And it doesn't make any sense for Nicaraguans. Nicaraguans don't use the phone. Like, there's no need to have a phone here. People don't do that. Like, can you? Yes, it's technically possible. Is it practical? No. What would you do with it? I have no idea. You do not get phones here. And as a digital nomad, you never get a phone in the place you're going to. You use the phone from where you're from, right? Phones really only make sense in a place where you're working because they're used as a work tool, not as a personal tool. Personal communications is by WhatsApp or whatever. So you're talking about a business device and you need this for work. So presumably it's with a US number. Having a Nicaragua phone and forwarding things is going to be a massive disaster because you're still going to be transferring a US call to Nicaragua, and that will be really obvious, mostly in your phone bill. So that's a huge problem. You don't want to do that. But it doesn't solve any problem, right? The thing that you want is to use your US phone in Nicaragua. All modern phones just do that. They work over the internet, so there's no reason to have that issue. If the thought process, and I have videos on this, is that somehow you can't use your US phone in Nicaragua, that's the fundamental problem. Of course you can. Your phone doesn't know where you are. It's the phone number that matters and where it's terminating. So if it's a personal phone, and it's got to be VoIP, right? If you don't have a VoIP phone, you need to join this millennium, because we're talking 90s is when people should have been thinking about switching. By 2001, everyone should have switched, right? There should be no landlines. And if you're talking cell phones, that is not appropriate for work calls. Like, it just doesn't make sense. You need to have a modern VoIP phone. This is not expensive. This is not hard. You have this with a US number. And then if your work is calling your personal line, then it's a US line, and you're just going to pick it up as same as if you're in the US. And if it's and you can put apps on your cell phone, so if you want to be portable and you want to have a cell phone, that's fine, or you want to use a portable VoIP phone, that's fine. Like, you have, the sky's the limit. the fact that you're in Nicaragua does not affect the phones. You just have to figure out if it's a personal phone or a work phone, do you need to hide it or do you need to have them send it to the US number? If it's your personal one, which it seems like because you're mentioning forwarding, then just like mine, right? I have a personal phone number from Geneseo, New York that I have had for decades. It's a VoIP number and it is still a Geneseo number that's upstate New York, like near Rochester and Buffalo. If you dial it, it rings here in Nicaragua because it's where the phone number is where you call. Where it rings is where you physically have the phone. The phone number and the physical location have no association with each other and haven't for a very long time, not since the copper wires of AT&T days in the 80s and 90s. So that, I think, is generally a problem that doesn't really exist, except for people who are holding on to really ancient technology, or people who are skipping having mainline phones and are only trying to work from cell phones. And then it poses some big problems because cell phones are still a legacy phone technology. So even those of us who have cell phones, which I do, and you need one for things, right? You need to connect, but for data. I got my first data-only phone in something like 2005, probably 2006. I'm probably pushing it a little bit too far. But by 2006, I definitely had two data-only phones. I could not make calls on them. One was a BlackBerry and one was a Motorola Q. And I used them for email and things like that. And back then, you couldn't make VoIP calls on them. They didn't have enough power. But today, and for a long time, every phone can. So instead of thinking of your cell phone as a cell phone number, which travelers don't do, it is a mini computer device that you carry around. Your cell service is for data. It's for internet, not calls. And then your VoIP service, whatever that is, goes on your phone or on your laptop or on your desktop or whatever, or a hardware phone on your desk. I have an actual phone sitting at my desk that I pick up and it's a US number, right? So if you dial my personal number in Geneseo or you dial my office number with the company in Texas, they ring my cell phone, but not my cell number, an application on my phone. They ring my desk phone, physical phone sitting on my desk. They will ring an application on my laptop. Whatever is convenient for me at the time, wherever I am in the world, it doesn't matter if I'm on vacation, it doesn't matter if I move, it doesn't matter if I'm home, it doesn't matter if I'm visiting my dad in New York. All of those places get those calls all the time. And so the concept of where I am does not exist in calling. That exists for my SIM card in my phone to make sure I have data, but it does not matter for making calls. That comes through the data. So once you move everything to data, you're protected from problems like that. Now, if you're doing that, right, you got to have it through a VPN if you want to hide where it is. That gets a little bit more complicated. But if you're just forwarding the calls or having them dial your number, then they never see that because there's no internet to track. There's no IP to check. The phone number is the only thing they get, and that's an American phone number. So it's generally not an actual problem. It's just people are perceiving phones in weird ways and don't realize how they work and how easy it is to have a very robust phone system when you are anywhere, right? But it's a part of living abroad already. You want that no matter where you are. So it's not like you need it just for this work situation. You need it for everything in life when you are a digital nomad. And then you become completely portable, right? If you're like me, it doesn't matter where I am. My laptop, my desktop, my phone, all of it goes anywhere in the world. I'm always able to work, always able to connect. And of course, from a personal standpoint, we're using WhatsApp and stuff like that. But from work, we might use, you know, a lot of people use Microsoft Teams. A lot of people use Google Office or Suite or whatever it's called. A lot of people use Zoho. That's what we use. We also have a complete suite of tools here in Nicaragua that do that. Things like Nika Abla and Nika, you know, all these different tools that we provide, Nika Mail, right? These things work everywhere. Right, they don't have these locational thinking kind of things. And so once you move to modern services, and of course your company does in some cases too, then you automatically have this freedom of movement, which is so important because companies that can't send people home during a pandemic, for example, really suffer. And everyone has learned that lesson and it really shouldn't be something that people need to learn again. That would be incredibly foolish. And I would recommend someone who did not update through the COVID pandemic and now thinks that those things that we learned, like people, everyone, there is no reasonable person that didn't know that those things were required, that people are not learning from that. And this is things that we knew for decades, right? 20 years ago, no respectable IT professional could ever have pretended to think it was okay to have systems that wouldn't let you work from home. They may have had challenges from politics at work or old systems they couldn't replace, but they knew that anything going in since the late 90s could not, with any professional respect, be done that way. Doing so would be absolutely unprofessional. It'd be negligent to do so. Now, many CEOs forced it because they were negligent and they were incompetent. That's standard. We expect CEOs to be incompetent. They're not trained. And if they were, the one thing they'd be trained to do is listen to the professionals in the different fields. Just like you don't override your lawyer, you don't override an IT professional. If you don't trust your IT professional, make sure you get one you trust. But don't trust them because they agree with you. Trust them because they know what they're doing. This is a mistake that people make often. CEOs have a tendency towards hubris and have a tendency to drive companies out of business. Let's face it, the average company goes out of business. So the average CEO is a failure. That's the way it works. And that's why IT professionals on average earn more than CEOs, at least in the systems administration area. Statistics tell you a lot about how these things work. So trust the people who are there to help. So for decades, no respectable professional could claim to be a trained professional and not know this is how you did things. And for almost a quarter century, we've had those systems ubiquitously, very cheap, very easy, very straightforward. Everybody was trained on how to do it, and common sense would tell you how to do it. It was just a matter of making it available, and then it became available. So to be at a company that hasn't updated for 25 years is ridiculous. To be at a company that hasn't learned from 25 years of best practices and common knowledge and basic common sense is ridiculous. To be at a company that went into COVID unprepared is ridiculous. And to now be at a company that didn't learn from all of those things, including COVID, is so absurd. It is such a statement about the incompetence of every person in the business. It is such a statement of the willingness against how obvious the incompetence is of people to work there in what must be an embarrassing environment. Every person has to sit every day and go, wow, I feel ridiculous for working at this place that doesn't care at all about doing a good job and saving money and being efficient and reducing risk. And it's so easy to do such a good job in that area that to find a company that today is going to cause these kinds of problems, hopefully we're not really going to find them. But working in IT, I know we do all the time. So it's very frustrating when companies are like, oh, we don't want to update, we don't care about, and then they have all these problems, and then they act like they didn't know, but they knew. There's nobody, IT or otherwise, right, who works in a position where they're overseeing a business and they don't either know that these things are true or they don't know that they intentionally shut down people who would have told them that these things are true, knowing that they didn't know, right? Nobody can avoid these things and make any plausible claim to being unknowledgeable of the fact that they were unknowledgeable. So I hope that gives you a foundation. Give me some feedback. Get down in the comments, especially you who asked the question, but other people as well. What very specific things do you need to solve? And we can talk about very specific things. I think that this kind of understanding how people work around real world scenarios is important, because it doesn't just help you understand how companies are failing and doing a terrible job. It exposes where you have opportunity to go, you know what, you could use an actual IT professional, or you could use a CEO that will listen to an actual IT professional. It's more often that than not having the IT pro. Although the number of companies who have zero IT and only salesmen, of course they're going to sell you terrible things to make sure you screw up, to make sure they can sell you more things, obviously. And if you hired them, again, how competent is your CEO if they hired a salesperson instead of a professional? Imagine if you were trying to do anything like that. Well, I wanted to hire a chef, and so I hired the guy that sells the frozen fish. He doesn't know how to cook, but he sure knows how to tell me what costs a lot, and then I buy it. Oh, wait, all my fish is expensive, spoiled, and no one knows how to cook it now? Guess what? Oh, I didn't know that salesmen weren't chefs. Yes, you did. Right? Everyone knows that. A five-year-old knows that. That is not a plausible excuse. It's not plausible deniability, right? CEOs, you don't get into that position having not a kindergartner level of knowledge of the world, right? So those kinds of things, this stuff exposes it, but it also helps to educate, like, how can you tackle these problems yourself? Because generally you can. right? Now, how willing are you to do it? How willing are you to keep up a facade of other things? Because what if your company's tracking your Facebook and you're posting social media stuff and then they catch you that way? Well, you have to consider, what are your risks? What are the things you're willing to do? Do you want to not be able to tell your coworkers where you live? Does your company actually care? Or are you just perceiving a problem that does not exist? Maybe you have a great company and they're like, oh, we have all this great technology. Everything just works. You just don't realize it, right? And you have this great culture and they're like, ah, go wherever makes sense. Like our company, right? Our company is what makes sense for you. Does it impact your job? If it doesn't, if we don't know where you are, we don't care where you are. We only care if we can figure it out because it was causing a problem, right? Oh, your latency is so high, you can't take phone calls. That's a problem. Your internet's always out. You didn't pay for good internet. That's actually not a problem where you are. That's a problem with the services you set up, right? Those are things that would be a problem in the US. It doesn't matter actually where you are. It matters only the artifacts that may or may not be caused by where you are. So that would happen the same. If you moved to Montana and had no internet and had no power, well, that would also be a problem, right? So it has nothing to do with where you go in our case, because we only care about the work that people get done. As long as you get your work done, nothing else matters because we're a business. Those two things are always connected. If you care about something other than what makes money, by definition, that makes you not a business. That makes you a hobby. And it's okay. It's okay to be a hobby, but it's important to recognize that it's not a business and that's not what you're there for. You're there for the whims of some person, not for supporting the investors. And a lot of investors would be interested to find out that they were investing into a hobby and not a business, because legally, hobbies are not allowed to have public investors. Thanks for joining me. Like and subscribe, share on social media, get down in those comments, ask your questions. I will see all of you tomorrow.